As Ed and Cynthia mentioned earlier, today's touchstone word is coping. The word coping evokes thoughts of popular phrases such as making the best of a bad situation, turning lemons into lemonade, weathering the storm, and bunker mentality. Webster Dictionary defines coping as the act of dealing with and attempting to overcome problems or difficulties. I think we know something about that. However, sometimes the choices we make to cope with a problem, such as chronic pain, can become the problem itself. And worse yet, we may not even be aware that our coping choice is a wrong turn. Our first session of the day takes a look at these hidden missteps. The moderator for our Coping Missteps and Pitfalls panel is Dr. Heather Papor King from Stanford University's Division of Pain Medicine. And our three women in pain panelists are Britt Johnson, Lynn Popadoc, and Sharon Wilkins. Let's welcome Dr. King.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Heather Papor King, and I am a pain psychologist from the Stanford Pain Management Center. I have to say that I'm just honored to be the moderator for today's panel. I wanted to give you just a very brief background about myself and then introduce our panelists today. At Stanford, I work with women that have pain conditions. I conduct both individual therapy. I also run a group coping skills group. And I also am board certified in biofeedback. And I am the main supervisor for the psychology postdoctoral fellows. And I'm also involved in helping to educate the medical fellows on the psychological aspect of chronic pain and coping. So I'd like to go ahead and introduce our lovely panelists today. First, we have Britt Johnson, better known through her blog, thehurtblogger.com, where she writes about the absurdity of living with chronic pain and two forms of autoimmune arthritis since the age of 7. She is a Stanford e-scholar, a member of the Stanford Medicine ePatient Advisory Board, and writes for creakyjoints.com. She works to create patient-centered care and design in healthcare systems and technology, and works to keep the user, the end user in sight, the patient, while adapting systems to be more cost-effective and efficient. You can find her most days on Twitter at hurtblogger.com. Next, we have Lynn Popadoc. As part of the chronic pain community, Lynn has had reflex sympathetic dystrophy for the past 13 years. She is a founding committee member and co-coordinator at the USC Pain Center's Quench the Fire event, and is currently working with RSD patient and fellow committee member Suzanne Miller. They are working on starting a chronic pain support group at USC. In addition, she's involved in special needs animal care, is a clarity and functional enhancement consultant and creative analyst, as well as an artist and a writer. And Sharon Wilkins. Sharon has lived in Southern California for almost 30 years. She's been married to her wonderful husband, Warren, for 38 years. Congratulations. She also has two sons. Her oldest son graduated in 2012 from Cal Arts Institute in Valencia and is specializing in animation. He's also worked for the Fox Network and is contracted out to others. And her other son graduated from high school in 2011 and is still finding his way. He'll find his way. Enjoy being young. Good. She's also worked in the healthcare industry in managed care for more than 25 years. So today, the panel is going to be sharing their own personal story regarding pitfalls or unhealthy coping, the things that they have struggled with through their journey to figure out how do you manage living with persistent pain. They also will share what they've learned from their mistakes and the steps that they've taken to cope more effectively with their chronic pain conditions. We feel that this topic is extremely important, given the fact that living with pain, as you all know, is incredibly challenging and it can be confusing. Today's goal is really just to, as Cynthia stated, to get real, to help you to recognize if you're engaging in any of these pitfalls that could actually be getting in your way. As you already know, coping with pain on the best days is challenging, and on the worst days, it can feel impossible and extremely overwhelming. The choices that you've made throughout your life to be successful can actually start to work against you when you have chronic pain. It's incredibly unfair, isn't it? Rushing through our day, being everything to everyone. Once you have pain, it doesn't really work. It's like the rules of life have changed and no one bothered to inform you. I'll often say to patients, and Cynthia actually commented on this earlier today, that if you're struggling to manage pain, well, welcome to normal. Pain in and of itself just doesn't make sense. And coping with pain actually isn't common sense. I think sometimes that's somewhat confusing. We think we should just there's a cognitive distortion right there, that we should just know what to do or know how to adjust to this. And I can tell you that it's difficult. And oftentimes we need forums like this to get a better sense of how to take these steps to manage pain more effectively. Once someone is diagnosed with chronic pain, I think making that cognitive shift away from searching for a pain generator or treating pain as though it's an acute pain condition when it's clearly turned into a chronic pain condition can be incredibly challenging. I honestly believe that's one of the hardest messages for a patient to hear. You have chronic pain, meaning that it's a chronic illness that has to be managed and that there is no magic cure. One step is not going to completely eliminate all of your symptoms and help you to restore function. Oftentimes, when people hear these messages, it can be followed by avoidance and denial, depression, and even, well, for many people, grief. What we do know is that how you cope with your pain is highly associated with your overall functioning and the quality of your life, more so than your actual pain condition or the acute injury itself, the original injury. So that's what our panelists are going to explore today. They're going to share their insight and their awareness around these issues, and they're going to enlighten all of us of how they've moved from the darkness into the light. So before I turn it over to our panelists, I just want to remind everyone that one goal of today's talk, although we want you to become aware of the choices you're making, we don't want you judging yourself. I would really invite everyone to enter into this with some compassion and forgiveness. I know Christina is going to be talking about forgiveness later on today, but maybe we could be overachievers and start early. Not to steal your thunder. So with that in mind, I would like to turn it over to Sharon to go ahead and start our panel discussion today on her coping pitfalls and missteps.
I've worked in the healthcare industry close to 30 years. I received a BA from Brandeis University with a double major in general science and African American studies, and I completed my master's in health policy and management at Harvard University. My first job in the industry was with Blue Cross of Massachusetts. At the time, Blue Cross had the largest number of contracts with hospitals than any of the other HMOs in the state. One of my department's responsibilities was exploring other providers Blue Cross could contract with to provide urgent and emergency care, such as community health centers and surgery centers. And if you think that would take business away from our hospital contracts, you would be right. We were a very small office in a very large corporation. But since Blue Cross was the major payer in the state, they did recognize that some services didn't need to be handled in a more expensive hospital setting. I moved to California and started working with United Health Plan and HMO. That's where I really got involved in managed care. The United Health Plan Network provided services to mostly Medi-Cal members. Lastly, I worked at Cal Optima of Orange County. I was the first director of provider services in their new county program. We contracted with providers to provide care to all of the Medi-Cal members in Orange County. From there, I went into healthcare consulting and pretty much did healthcare consulting until I stopped working in May 2005. The reason I took the time to talk a little bit about my background is because my goal has always been to get back to being able to do the consulting that I pretty much was trained to do and enjoyed doing for so many years. Since I stopped working in 2005, I really didn't get back to my consulting until this year because of all the ups and downs and trying to regulate my medications and all of that. I stopped working because I was having so much problems and pains, physical problems, getting back and forth to work. I was walking with a limp and having difficulty making my daily 4-hour commute. I stopped working to focus on what was wrong with me. A neurologist suggested I might have multiple sclerosis in August and referred me, August 2006, and referred me to the Casa Colina complex in Pomona, which is one of three facilities in Southern California. Now, when they referred me to Casa Colina, I did what I usually do, which was, I remember saying to the doctor that I had a vacation to go on the next week, and what should I do? Should I take the time out to see what was wrong with me or take the vacation? He said, oh no, go ahead and take your vacation and then start working on it. So of course, not only did I take the vacation, this was August of 2005, I didn't bother to really check in and schedule an appointment until March of 2006. Casa Colina was like a mini medical complex offering all types of therapies. And now there I was officially diagnosed with multiple sclerosis in March of 2006. At the time, my limp was more pronounced, but I wasn't using a cane at that time. I was prescribed Copaxone and started doing daily injections in July of 2006. In about 2008, I started taking additional medicines, Visicare for incontinence, Nexium for acid reflux, Baclofen for spasms, and Ampira to help me walk better. I can walk better, but I find that on a day-to-day basis, it's easier to be pushed to places in my wheelchair sometimes because when I do walk, when I get up in the morning, I have a lot of energy, and during the course of the day, that energy kind of dissipates. So if I am pushed to different events and so forth, I actually have the energy to participate in things, whereas if I tried to walk on my walker or whatever, I'd be so tired once I got to the event, I probably wouldn't be able to do much. I was also prescribed a low-dosage medicine for high blood pressure shortly after that. At the time, I was 58 years old, and that was the first time I had started taking a high blood pressure medicine. I started to take Tramadol, HCL, for pain in my joints and lower back. Since I have a high tolerance for pain and I don't like to take medication, I generally don't take much medication. Before I started taking medicine for the MS, I didn't take more than a few aspirins per year for headaches. That's when I started to think about how much pain could I live with, because I started to think that I wanted to figure out a way to come off of some of the different medications that I was taking, especially my pain medication. I was taking, my doctor initially prescribed Tramadol 4 times a day, every 6 hours to eliminate the pain. And it did eliminate the pain. I was taking about, each pill was about 50 milligrams. I found that it not only eliminated the pain, but put me in a vegetative state where I didn't want to do much of anything. I pretty much sat for long periods of time. The TV was on, but I wouldn't really know what was on. I really didn't do much of anything. I found that I was more of like a vegetative state, but I didn't have any pain. I would sit for hours doing nothing. After several weeks of inactivity, I realized that I needed to reduce my dosage. I started by cutting back the amount of pills I was taking. I cut them back by half. I started taking medicines in the morning when I got up, and at night before I went to bed. I figured if I needed to take additional medicines, I could always do that if I was in any kind of pain. But I also realized that by taking the reduced medicines, I was going to probably have some discomfort and pain. And I do have discomfort and pain. In fact, I have discomfort and pain right now, but it's not enough for me to take any more additional medicine right now. Of course, if it gets bad enough, I will take the medicine. I started to think that if I cut the dosage even more, such as not taking it at night when I go to bed, then I would only be taking it once a day. So that's what I did. I figured if it became uncomfortable enough and I couldn't sleep again, I could always take the medicine. I noticed that I could go most days feeling minimal pain. And again, like I said, I'm not going to say that I was pain-free. I did have pain, but I was able to live with it. I usually experience pain when I have a lot of activity, when I'm moving around a lot, such as when I go to church, shopping, dinner, and times like the day while I'm at this conference. To get up and get ready to come to something like this, I live in San Dimas, is quite an effort. By the time you get showered and dressed and have your breakfast, I literally have to be pushed in my wheelchair out to the car because I'm so tired at that point, and I still have the rest of the day to go through. Generally with multiple sclerosis, you find that you have periods where you can work and you need to rest. You're going to be your strongest in the morning after you've had a full night's sleep, preferably 7 hours. And then you can, during the course of the day, you're going to lose energy. So you can sit for a while and to regain that energy, but you're never going to have the total amount of energy you have when you wake up in the morning. So usually by about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I find that it's probably the best time not to have much to do. So such on a day like this, I probably will have additional pain. And if I have the pain, I'm more than likely I will take the medication, which is my response to my initial question of how much pain am I really willing to live with, which is probably not very much at this point. Thank you.
I have, like Dr. King was saying, I've had RSD for over 13 years now and have recently been diagnosed with osteoporosis and arthritis and fibromyalgia. So I can definitely relate to having a lot of energy in the morning and what happens if you don't get enough rest and having to get ready for something like this. You know, I already, even after we set up our table, our exhibitor table outside, I was a little tired and thinking, wouldn't it be nice if I could, you know, lie down for a half an hour? So I was grateful to hear you have that, the room now, you know, the room with the couches and the cots and things. That was the highlight of my morning. And I'm sure, I know Cynthia, for one, has probably heard this. I I grew up under very unique circumstances. I raised myself, I raised my sister. I worked while I went to school. I had a job. I've been working pretty much since I was probably 6 or 7 years old. I did factory work, I did all sorts of things. And I've been through a lot of terrifying and horrific experiences that nobody should have to go through. You know, pain aside, these were things that happened to me as I was growing up. But rather than lashing out and being angry, I found myself saying, you know, okay, in order to survive, what do I have to do? I'm going to have to look at what has come to me or what has happened to me, what I've experienced, and soak it in, learn how to respond, question it, take from it what works for me, learn what doesn't work for me, what did I do wrong in my responses, and take all that and move on. And because of all that, I would hear much later, in fact, to this day, I hear people saying this, you know, you're such a strong person. You know, you handle everything so well. I don't know how you do it. It's amazing. Like Cynthia said, what's the trick? What's your secret? And so when I was first diagnosed with the RSD, which took me 5 doctors to finally find someone who knew what RSD was, I found myself, we were talking about this outside, I found myself schooling the doctors and thinking, oh, okay, well, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. I'm supposed to be teaching the doctors about RSD. You know, what I could find out, this is 13 years ago, and I was more than happy to take that on. I was like, okay, well, fine, here, I'll teach you. Until I finally decided, you know, this wasn't doing me any good, and I found my pain getting worse and worse, but, you know, I was trying to offset it by what I could teach people. And what I've done is replace that with mentoring people who have just been diagnosed with RSD, because it is a slap in the face, kick in the gut, you know, punch in the kidneys type of diagnosis. When you read about it and you say, there is no way that I can have this. This is impossible. I can't see myself having this. I can't see myself going through this. This just, you know, what I'm reading is just terrible. But, and so because I would keep hearing that, you're so strong, what do you do? I started speaking to classes, and I started, which I still do. I talked in front of some classes at USC for occupational pain and physical therapy. I would come in and just describe to them what I do right, what I think I do wrong still, and try to give them a chance to ask me questions and things that they probably wouldn't feel comfortable doing with their own patients. So that's been very rewarding. But when I told my family that I had RSD, the first thing that my mother said, well, you know, I heard her say, well, she's always been a strong person, she can handle this. And so when I you can relate, yeah, she's always been a strong person, you should see what she's been through, it's, you know, this is nothing compared to, you know, some of that, this will just be, and this isn't just my mom talking, these are other people, these are friends that I had, and people that I knew, and people that, and other members of the family, you know, that I've always been, oh, just, you know, it'll be fine, you just go see your doctor, and, you know, he'll give you something for it. And we all know that doesn't work. We all know there is nothing for it. You know, we all have our own way of dealing with things. But as a result of all of these things that I thought were so wonderful and making me strong and making me cope and making me able to be the one that everybody would come to, I fell into that trap of believing that I could handle this on my own. I thought, you know, I am a strong person. I can do this. I can handle this. I don't need anybody to help me. And I didn't want to put that burden on anybody. You know, I already had that experience of being, of of not really understanding what I was doing, and it was a big weight, I thought, just to take care of myself. And I thought, why would I want to? I don't want to share that weight with anybody else. I don't want to put that burden on anybody else. And that's a whole, I could have my own conference on that alone. I could talk a lot about that. But falling into that trap of believing that you can do it on your own was very dangerous for me, because I did try to do it on my own for years. I was in the midst of lawsuits, and I lost my job, I lost my insurance, my boyfriend took a walk, I lost everything, my house, my furniture. I was just, so pretty much, you know, there wasn't anything left except for me. And I thought, well, this just means I have to start over again. You know, I'm strong, I can do this. And as a result, when I figured out, you know, I am hurting more as a result of trying to do this, and I was very disappointed in myself that I couldn't handle it. I was constantly trying to prove myself. I kept trying to work. I thought, if I lost that job, then I'm going to find another job. I got my car modified. It's like, okay, how am I going to, you know, I was determined to keep working, and I was determined to go to the bathroom on my own. I was determined to carry my own cup, walk my dog, you know, the simple things. I thought, there's no way I'm going to go through life depending on somebody and having that burden on somebody to help me along the way. I'm strong. I can do this. So then, in turn, that disappointment, that extreme frustration, always striving to put on my best face for my family and my friends and my doctor, I would go in and say, well, you know, don't we all love that? But you look good. You look fine. You look like you're doing really well today. You know, you look like you feel good. Okay, that's not the doctor for me. And I did change doctors, I said, many times, based on the fact that you have to see someone, this is an aside, you have to see someone who actually understands what a pain person is going through and how to communicate with the pain, with somebody within the pain community. I have an article going on that, and because for the past 13 years I've been keeping track of what people say that as a member of the pain community is they've only said, or they only believe, and it's based on a lack of understanding of what chronic pain patients go through. So I've been keeping track of all these things and my reactions to them, and that's helped a little bit. I don't journal, and I don't go to support groups on a regular basis, and that's just my way of coping, because I always think I don't want it to take more time out of my life than it already does. So I have to pace myself when it comes to support groups and things like that. But putting on your best face, I wanted to have that sense of normalcy for myself. I wanted I almost wanted somebody to say, well, you look good. And I thought, okay, well, I'm going to create a positive feedback loop for myself. You know, I look good. I'm going to believe that I look fine, that I'm not in pain, but not in a way that was any type of denial. It was more of, I can feel good. There is a matter of mind over matter that I thought was really important and that worked for me, you know. And it wasn't, it was, you know, maybe a little bit of blowing smoke, we all have. But as far as I never denied that I had RSD. I never was angry that I had RSD. I was more frustrated and disappointed about how I reacted to the fact that I couldn't be strong enough to deal with it by myself without anybody else involved. And I have something that I meant to bring today, and I left it right by the door, of course. I have a piece of metal art on my wall. It's the only thing on my wall. It's about the size of this piece of paper. on a big wall, and it says, if in life you trip, make it part of the dance. And I thought that was so wonderful. I thought, that's true. You know, this is, again, this is before the RSD came on. I thought, what a wonderful way to look at life. You can, you know, yeah, you trip, you fall. Okay, well, you pick yourself back up and you pretend it's part of whatever you were doing. You know, you be strong enough to handle it because you are a strong person. And it was how I lived my life, and it is how I live my life, only I realize now it's a wonderful mantra as long as you believe what it says in the perspective of what it says. I was creating something much more out of that than there was. And so whenever I look at that, I still think it's wonderful. I don't look at it the same way. And I think what a wonderful gift I've been given to realize that that now that I understand what that says in perspective, and that I understand I don't have to dance solo. And that is not what defines me. It's not the fact that I can do this by myself. And as a follow-up to that, another misstep was could I had to ask myself, could I suffer less if I weren't so attached to my previous self? I had a fabulous job that I loved. I was, and on top of that, the cherry on top, I was making lots of money. I had friends. It was, you know, do what you love and the money will follow. It took me a long time to get there, but I happened to fall into this. My background is in medicine, and I studied radiation physics and biology for 6 years, and worked out at the Nevada test site. And so I have a science researcher, a scientist researcher background. And I ended up not being in that field and moving on, but I've had several careers since then. But I happened to fall into one that I really, really loved. And I was working 7 days a week. I had my animal rescue. I just had this really, really, really wonderful life, friends and everything. And I thought, after all that was gone, I really suffered that loss. And I was introduced to the five stages of grief in grieving for the person that it was okay to grieve for the person that you were before you were afflicted with RSD or multiple sclerosis. And it didn't mean you had to give up who you were in your heart and how big your heart was and the things you believed in, but you do have to allow yourself to grieve for those parts of your life that you're not going to have back again. It is a loss. There is, you know, when you mentioned that earlier, I thought that is exactly what I want to hit on. Allow yourself to go through those stages of grief. You have a right to be angry. You have a right to be depressed. You have a right to be, you know, you have a right to say, you know what, I just don't want this. I'm going to make believe I don't have it. As long as you keep moving, though, and progressing through those steps. But it really made a big difference to me after I went through all of the agony of believing that I could handle this and I'm such a strong person, to asking myself, could I suffer less if I didn't hold on to that attachment to my previous self? And it has made a huge difference. Thank you.
So I can so relate to everything you're saying. I feel like I could have said 90% of what you just said. Same with you. It's really interesting when you live with chronic pain, you know, the story becomes the same, you know, just with the little bitty details changed a little bit. So as Dr. King said, I've been living with, two forms of arthritis since I was a child, since I was 7 years old. So my story is a little different, having grown up with it. And in a sense, I kind of don't remember what it's like not to live life in pain. In some ways, I think that's really fortunate because I haven't had to grieve a previous life in a lot of ways. That's not to say I still don't go through those steps because my disease is ever progressing and ever getting worse at the same time. When I was 7 years old, I contracted rheumatic fever. I had repeated strep and ended up with rheumatic fever. Woke up in the middle of the night with my wrists and ankles locked so tight that I crawled to my parents' bedroom, not being able to function. And, you know, the next morning, our family doctor just, you know, had that look on his face that said something is very wrong here. And from there, you know, I lived in a very small town in Texas at the time. I was told all sorts of things, that I had temporary juvenile rheumatoid arthritis, which is not even really a thing. There's no such thing as temporary, which we quickly learned, unfortunately. You know, I had a fairly good childhood. I was very lucky that my arthritis did not set in early and did not cause a lot of deformity. So I, you know that's a blessing for me, certainly. But as I progressed into my teens, things started getting much worse. And as I hit puberty, you know, my pain was kind of always there, and started about in sixth grade, I guess, when I was about 12 years old. Things, you know, I realized at that point, you know, how different my life was and was going to be as well, because I started carrying a pillow to school to support my back, and, you know, other sixth graders don't do that sort of thing. And then, you know, going into my teen years, people constantly teased me because I was always the girl that was hurt. Well, you know, I had braces, or I was on crutches, or, you know, my wrist was in a cast, my foot was in a cast, you name it. And so people always assumed, you know, what did you do to yourself now? And it was really hard for me to explain that to people, that no, this is just something that I always live with. It's, you know, yes, I technically hurt myself because I was doing something stupid, but it's because of this underlying problem. So for me, growing up with it really forced me to internalize a lot of things very differently, and forced me to hide things very differently. And the other issue is too, I was not technically diagnosed for 14 years because of the way I look, and that I still like to, you know, look like myself and, you know, like a vibrant young woman, and I wear bright lipstick because I like to fool the world that I'm not in pain. You know, people don't believe what I have, and that translated into the doctors as well. So it wasn't until I was 20 years old that I was actually diagnosed with what is called undifferentiated spondyloarthropathy. Say that five times fast, which is basically arthritis of the spine. And because I didn't show all those technical hallmarks and so forth, which I'm fortunate for, I went a long time without being diagnosed and therefore not having my pain believed. So for me, there was a lot of denial for a long time. It was very easy for me to say, well, if my doctors don't see it, even though I knew in my heart of hearts that I had this and I knew that it had always been there, but if these doctors don't see it and they don't believe me and they're not willing to treat it, maybe I don't have it. Maybe I can push beyond that. And so I went through a long time of, you know, kind of trying to convince myself that no, you know, this is what you have, and you have to push for answers, and you have to push for understanding, and you have to push for help. And it wasn't until I was actually 23 years old, I went through a lot of doctors, like you're saying, that I found a rheumatologist who said, you know, I think she understood that mental pain that I dealt with of not ever finding the proof of my disease and the fact that people could sort of write me off. So she said, you know, we're going to find that proof. And it was both a blessing and a curse at the same time. And I'll never forget, I was on the way to my family's house for Thanksgiving that year. And she called me. It was 8 p.m. the night before Thanksgiving. And she was still working. You know, that's how much she cared about her patients. And she called me and she said, well, she said, I just want to clarify, you've never actually had children. I said, no. She said, you've never been pregnant, not even once. And I said, no. She said, well, because your lower back and hips look like you've had at least 10 or more children in your life. And no one had found it up to that point. So, you know, it was at that point that I couldn't deny it anymore, and my doctors couldn't deny it anymore. So a blessing and a curse. So as I grieved at that point, because, you know, I had to be honest with myself and move on at that point, but I could also start moving ahead and start making healthy choices, and knew that I could start also managing my disease much better. And at that point, you know, I realized having a firm diagnosis and, you know, having this proof, it made it much easier for me to kind of share my journey and my story and to help other people not have to suffer through what I did as well. So talking about those missteps and everything, you know, denial was a big part of it for me.
And I think dealing with pain in my teens and then going into college in my early 20s, a very easy thing for me, and since I wasn't on medications that were controlling my underlying condition, I did feel a lot of pain and I lost a lot of sleep. And so when you're in college, a very easy thing to do is self-medicate through alcohol, and it's very true. You know, that's not to say I don't think I necessarily ever had a problem with it, but looking back on it, I realized that I was self-medicating a lot more than I thought. I would come home at the end of the day completely exhausted and hurting and not really aware of what I was feeling because I had always felt pain in my life. So it's taken me a long time to step back and realize that this is what pain feels like for me. For me, it is a level of exhaustion, it's irritability, it's an inability to sit still. It's being mad with everybody else in the room, it's being mad with everybody around me. Not wanting to do the things that I love to do, you know, that. So for me, learning what pain was very different. And I realized that when I came home from college, you know, I was, you know, popping open the bottle of wine, having a glass of wine and going to bed much earlier than I should have, because it was much easier to do that and to sleep it off and not to think about things. And I'm grateful that, you know, I don't have an addictive personality, so that was never an issue. And using pain medication was never an issue. But looking back on that, I know that sleeping too much through my teens and sleeping too much through college was a way of coping, and an inappropriate way of coping as well. And so going into that now, I was telling Dr. King just beforehand, one of the ways that I found to manage my disease, because for me, well, I forgot to mention, I also live with chronic migraines, which is just, you know, throw that, it's the cherry on top of everything. For me, triggers are a huge thing. So food, alcohol is a massive trigger. I cannot drink at this point, but food specifically. And for me, I've made the choice to eat a completely vegan diet at this point because I know that meat triggers me, dairy triggers me, all these sorts of things. You know, I know that if I eat this, I'm going to be in pain within a few hours, or I'm going to wake up the next day and not be able to function. So that is a continual choice that I have to make every day. And I know this seems like such a small thing, and that's why I wanted to touch on it, because this is a choice that you can make throughout your day every day, you know, and I have to make consciously every day. And I've been dealing with a lot of stress lately. I was very sick, and I've been flaring, and I've been trying to get my health back on track in the last few weeks. And so that level of stress just makes everything go out the window and make you not want to deal with your, you know, disease appropriately. So even just last night, you know, I'm preparing for this, getting ready, and I'm so exhausted, and I had a friend over, and we just decided, let's just order some food. And we're looking at this Greek menu, and I thought, oh, lamb gyro, that sounds perfect, you know, which has lamb, which is meat on it, which will make me flare, and it has, you know, the delicious tzatziki sauce on it, which is yogurt-based, again, which I knew. And I thought to myself, you know, I'm so stressed out, I deserve this. I just deserve this. And I was about to order it, and then I just started laughing to myself. I thought, how can I, in good faith and in good conscience, get up on the stage tomorrow and tell people to make better decisions when I'm sitting here trying to make this decision tonight? So I stopped myself and I ate the appropriate foods, and that's why I'm here this morning and able to move, and I'm gesturing and, you know, and able to talk, and I'm not swollen. So, you know, I made those decisions even though I was having a rough night last night. And it's consciously making those decisions every single day throughout your day, knowing what are your triggers and what are good and not. The other thing I really wanted to talk about is white lies that we all tell ourselves, and that plays into the denial and white lies that I tell friends and family around me. You know, it's really easy, especially growing up with this. A way of coping was just to not talk about it. It was much easier to not talk about it, and you know, if we didn't talk about it, it wasn't present in the room. And I didn't talk to friends about it. I never tried to explain my disease because it was just a lot easier. Just, you know, if they didn't know, we didn't know, we didn't talk about it, I could be a person and I wasn't, you know, a patient with a number, basically. And even with my family, it took a long time for me to be honest about when I was in pain, even though they were picking up on those subtle clues for years without me really realizing it. You know, they ask you, how are you doing? And always the response is, oh, I'm fine. I'm fine, you know, and it's going back to that strength thing that you're saying, oh, you're so strong. It's like, well, and what I always say is, you know, what I've communicated since I was little is I feel little today, you know, I don't feel very big today. I don't feel very strong. You know, I don't feel like I have it in me to do much. And that was an easy way of communicating that for me. And I still use that, you know, especially with my parents, you know, it kind of harkens back to when I was a child. And, but just constantly saying, I'm fine is not the appropriate thing. And I still do it, and my dear mother is very good about still stopping me and saying, no, you're not, you know, or, you know, saying, well, you know, what's really going on today. But at the same time, the more I've communicated with them, they've learned to also know when it's not okay to ask me. They know that sometimes by merely asking me that they will halt my ability to cope with that pain. And so that's really important to communicate with the people that are around you on a day-to-day basis or the people that you interact with, because for me, sometimes I've been able to block out the pain mentally or somehow, and I don't even realize what's going on. And then someone will stop me, like my husband just this morning, you know, I was tossing and turning in bed. I woke up before my alarm clock because I was in pain. He said, are you okay? And I said, no, I'm not, you know. And he knew that because of how I was tossing and turning. But sometimes just being asked, are you okay, is just enough to make me realize what I'm actually dealing with. So it's important to communicate with the people around you when is a good time to ask that and when is not a good time to ask that, because sometimes it's enough to set me off and I go, oh crap, now I need to take some medicine, you know, because it's all coming flooding in, you know, because that broke down my mental barrier to be able to deal with it. So communication with the people around you is terribly important. And those little white lies then also that I would tell my family with I'm fine, you know, had bled into my friends, and that really created a sense of isolation. And that's something that's never going to go away, but we can at least get better about it. Like Cynthia said, you know, that's something you have to accept is going to be part of your life now, is that isolation. For me, I just wouldn't tell my friends what was going on. And, you know, I would always come up with something. Oh, I'm sick. You know, I've got that cold that's running around. Or, you know, Friday night rolled around and I'd fabricate something again. Oh, I've got food poisoning this night. Oh, well, that sucks. You know, sorry, you can't do it. And I would just never be honest with my friends, because it was much easier to tell them something that they understood than trying to explain my actual disease. And then, you know, I knew it was a problem when I started weaving my husband into those fabricated lies. And so, you know, we'd sit there and we'd come up with something knowing that I wouldn't be able to do something on a Friday or Saturday night. And, well, I was sick last week, so, you know, what can we pull off this week with you? And, you know, well, you had food poisoning 3 weeks ago. We can't use that this weekend, you know. So I knew when we started fabricating ever more intricate lies that, you know, that was a real problem. So, you know, it's only been within the last few years that I've really, and that came with starting my blog as well, that gave me the ability to be more honest, not just with the people around me and helping them, but honest with myself as well. And that gave me the ability to also talk with my friends as well, and let them know what I was going through. And just also sharing with them and allowing them to read what I go through, help them understand what I do deal with on a day-to-day basis. And just opening up to them and communicating with them better has come back to me in so many incredible ways, and I can't encourage all of you enough to communicate and be more honest with the people around you and stop those white lies, because now my friends see that, and you know, we'll be walking somewhere and it just amazes me how much they get it now. We'll be walking somewhere and there's a flight of stairs, and in my head I'm going, okay, well, I'll deal with this. I'm not going to make a big fuss over it again. But now my friends will say, oh, I see an elevator over there. And it just nearly wants, you know, nearly brings tears to my eyes, because they start seeing the world through my eyes now. And they'll ask me, they'll say, well, we were planning on doing this tonight, but is that going to be too physically demanding on you now? And so, well, let's do plan B. And it's just not even an issue. And so by giving myself the gift of communication, I now can kind of be that person that I want to be a little more. And I find myself being more active with friends and family, and I'm able to get out, you know, and be that person a little bit. Because like Sharon, I had to quit working a few years ago. I completely stopped working full-time in December of 2010 because my chronic migraines had gotten so terrible that I couldn't work anymore. And so for me, those last 3 years have been, I'm going to get back to that. And the truth is, I'm never going to get back to that. And luckily, I found a higher purpose, a better meaning in what I'm doing now. But it's still not full-time work, and I still can't get there. So in a sense, I have grieved that person that I used to be, but I am getting back to me and figuring out who I am moving forward with this, and that's really important. So daily choices and communication are key.
As the moderator, I promise to keep us on time. And I promise, Cynthia and John, I am watching the clock. I wanted to just, One, thank the panelists for being so brave and so honest. I think it's easy to talk about how we're doing when we feel like we have it all figured out. You know, when we're doing well and it's like, yeah, I've got this all figured out. It's easy to sit up and talk about it, but I think it's hard to be very open, and it's, I just appreciate it so much. And I'm, yeah. We hope that you can take the information that was shared today and really explore it throughout today's conference and hopefully longer than that, to recognize if you're engaging in any of these choices that the panelists have shared, you know, whether it's relying on medication as a complete elimination of pain, with the consequence being, you know, what Sharon talked about of, well, complete elimination of consciousness also, or, you know, not making healthy behavioral choices, not communicating with family and friends, a lot of the self-talk, trying to be the person you were before you had your pain condition, or even thinking of struggling as some sort of a personal flaw. That's a dangerous one. We all struggle. It's normal to struggle, and it's incredibly normal when you have pain to struggle with, how am I going to manage this? How am I going to share this with my friends and family? How am I going to do this for the rest of my life? So I hope that you can, you know, really absorb that message that if you're struggling, it's normal, and it is absolutely not a personal flaw. Absolutely not. I wanted to use the remaining time that we have to open it up to the audience. If you have any questions for the panelists, and I'm actually going to move my chair because I realize I've been completely ignoring the other side of the of the audience, so you can see the panelists better. So a question for any of the panelists. They've got it all figured out. Good job, guys. Absolutely. Yeah.
I love what you said about grieving the person who you were. That really helps me. You know, I mean, I always feel like I'm not supposed to. I let myself grieve. I let myself go to bed and be depressed. And I think it's all over. And then I finally get up with a new idea and it's been 25 minutes, you know. But I just really appreciate that about letting yourself grieve your old self. People get mad at me for wanting to do that, and that's really, really important.
It was really interesting when I discovered that. It was one of those things I stumbled onto, and that happened just as an aside for something completely different. And when it happened, it was, you know, I thought, that makes sense, because the person who happened to be there in the situation that we were dealing with, I had just been talking about how hard I was working to, you know, and how frustrated I was because I couldn't do this and I couldn't do that anymore, and how I was trying to resolve that by taking those things that I liked about doing this, or that I liked about doing that, or that were gratifying to me about, you know, in my work, to, instead of trying to get back to that work, to take those things from it that I liked and try to apply those to something else. I did the same thing with my art. I used to do a lot of fine line pen and ink. You know, everything was very, very detailed, and all of a sudden, you know, I can't hold a pencil still. And I thought, okay, well, let's sit down and write down, what about that did I really like? Does it have to be pen and ink? You know, does it, or could it be something different? You know, I liked the fact that I was being creative. I liked the fact that I could do it on my own time. So all of these things that this list I was making, and I would just, and I still do it. I tape full size sheets of paper down, lined, in certain places in the house. And so when I think of something, you know, I'll write it down, and that goes into a book eventually. So when I have those moments that I'm, you know, feel that I'm going through those stages of grief, And one of the things that helps me once it helped me get to acceptance is looking at those lists and thinking, you know, I still can be that person, but not in that same way. And that made a big difference.
I just wanted to add that also to remind yourself that when you're going through the stages of grief, they're not linear. And you can reach acceptance, and then you can actually be in a situation where you're back into anger or denial. You can go back and forth as much as you need to, Cynthia. It's absolutely normal.
It's so interesting to hear your openness. I really appreciate it. But a thought suddenly occurred to me. What's your opinion of, like, your husband's... how are you affected by the people, the caregivers, if you will, or the people around you that are not, that don't experience what you're going through, but are the closest thing to you? What are you thinking of how they're thinking about it?
Absolutely.
Not quite a mind reader. So you're asking, I guess, you know, how do we deal with how they're dealing with it, I guess, or to some extent? That is a constant learning process every single day. For me, I'm still a newlywed. I just had my first wedding anniversary recently. Been with my husband now 5 years. Thanks. I'm very fortunate to have found someone to deal with me and to love me and be there with me. That is a weekly conversation, I would say. We knew each other from college, and he sort of knew me without knowing what was wrong with me. And, you know, he knew that other side of me. And I think to some extent he grieves that other person I used to be too. And that comes up to some extent sometimes too is, well, you know, I wish we could do those things, or I wish, you know, I wish you were, you know, I knew you or had you 10 years ago or something like that. And that conversation does come up. So for me, it's just being cognizant and aware that it's both of us that live with the disease. I'm not the only one that lives with the disease. He lives with it just as much as I do. And knowing how that affects him, the stress that puts on him, the financial responsibility that he feels to take care of me as well, which is huge. It's being cognizant of that and knowing that I have to, validate it as well. And, you know, it just as much as he has to validate my feelings and the pain that I'm going through, because there's a lot of physical, mental pain there. But it's a weekly conversation, you know, that we have, you know, and kind of checking in with each other. You know, this is how I'm doing this week, and, you know, how are you doing this week, going through work and dealing with me, and, you know, kind of catching up. Because for a long time I realized that I was protecting him from what I was going through, because I when we had time together, I just wanted it to be us, and I didn't want to have to worry about my disease, which I've named Arthur. Arthritis. So Arthur was always in the room, you know. So, you know, there's this third wheel in the room all the time. And, you know, I just wanted it to be the two of us, so I wouldn't tell him things. And then he would overhear conversations that I was having with my mother, and he'd go, you know, I had no clue that you're going in for an MRI in 2 days. You know, why didn't you tell me? And, oh, sorry, you know. And it wasn't purposeful. It was just me trying to protect him. So I realized that I have to communicate with him just as much and not try to protect him, because he knows, you know, and he sees it, and he can read all the body language in me and everything. And it's just also communicating with him that sometimes when I'm cranky, it's not towards you. It's my disease. And he's gotten good about saying, you know, are you hurting right now? You know, if we do get into some sort of argument, and I step back and take a breath and go, okay, this is my problem right now, and I need to deal with it, you know, and not take it out on you. So it's a constant learning process, I would say, so.
Actually, I've been married about a very long time, for like 38 years, and we've had an opportunity, my husband and I, to go through a time when we were, you know, had no children, and we were able to take a number of vacations. We were actually dinks at one point, with a double income, no kids, so we were able to take really nice vacations for a long time. We've lived in, recently moved from a very upscale community that we were in for about 26 years. So we've done a lot of things and had a lot of very ups, and then we now with me having the multiple sclerosis, a lot of things have changed. Our income situation has changed very drastically. Fortunately, my kids have been able to, you know, my son, his oldest son actually has been able to complete school and all of that, but he had to take on a lot of loans to do that kind of thing. So we've actually gone through the gamut of having a lot of income and a lot of opportunities and so forth, moving down to a place where we're living in an apartment at this time, and we don't have that kind of financial resources that we had at the time. But I think over the years we've had an opportunity to do a lot of things that we probably wouldn't have. I'm glad we did them at the time, because right now it would probably be depressing not to know, you know, not to go on the cruises and the things like that we've done in the past. I try to be very appreciative of my husband, because I know he's actually gone through a lot after so many years, to the point where, you know, I'm not as able to move around as much as I did before in the past. And I'm not a person that does a lot of complaining, and that's just basically my nature in a sense. So fortunately, a good thing about that is by having the multiple sclerosis, I didn't change into a person who does a lot of complaining. So that's a good thing, I think. Mm-hmm. So at least, you know, I think we've kind of gotten to a point where we're sort of, we can look back on our lives and things and realize that we have had certain accomplishments. And this is actually a time in our lives after being married for so long, and we're both in our 60s, that we would be slowing down anyhow. So I guess not having the opportunity to do the cruises and things like that is a good thing, since it was a lot harder for me to travel at this time and all of that. We do find we actually get away. You sort of redefine your lifestyle in a sense. The advantage of not being in such a big house is not having to clean such a big house. So you start looking at things a lot different in that sense.
Thank you. Another round of applause for the panelists. Thank you.